groups or families from our BAS prayer book. And the service begins on page 687. God is our light and our salvation, and in his name we have lit these candles. May they remind us of the beauty of his truth and the radiance of his love. May our hearts be open to the light of Christ now and at all times. Lord, in your mercy, let there be light. O God, you command a light to shine out of darkness. Shine in our hearts that we may be as lights in the world, reflecting the glory of Jesus in our lives. God is light, and in him is no darkness. We'll have an opening hymn. Almighty and ever-living God, who fulfilled the promises of Easter by sending us your Holy Spirit and opening to every race and nation the way of life eternal, keep us in the unity of your Spirit, that every tongue may tell of your glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We'll now have a piece of music for praise.
Thank you. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds and power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea, and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they will prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm this morning is Psalm 104, beginning at the 25th verse. O Lord, how manifold are your works! In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Yonder is the great and wide sea, with its living things too many to number, creatures both small and great. They move the ships, and there is the Leviathan, that you have made for the sport of it. And all of them look to you to give them their food in due season. You gave it to them, they gather it. You open your hand, and they are filled with good things. You hide your face, and they are terrified. You take away their breath, and they die and return to the dust. You send forth your Spirit, and they are created, and so you renew the face of the earth. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in all his works. He looks at the earth and it trembles. He touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will praise my God while I have my being. May these words of mine please him. I will rejoice in the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Hallelujah.
Send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, He will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify because you have been with me from the beginning. But I've said these things to you so that when their hour comes, you may remember that I told you about them. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asked me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you, and when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We're going to take this opportunity to reflect on today's readings, in particular the Book of Acts. And the question that comes to mind is, what in the world happened that day? And that is a theological question, plus it is a very practical question. Imagine ourselves being at a celebration, perhaps a dinner party, to celebrate a birthday or an anniversary, and suddenly a violent windstorm and fire erupt all around us. Chances are we would respond with confusion and fear. The scene might become chaotic as people try to determine what is happening. People would begin to formulate ideas of what happened. They would begin to ask questions and come to conclusions. Is this not what we heard today in the reading from the Book of Acts? We heard many people coming to conclusions about what was happening there at that particular time. People had gathered for the celebration of Pentecost, the 50th day after Passover. It was the ever so popular Feast of Weeks to celebrate the early harvest. We as a church gathered today to celebrate Pentecost. It is now 50 days since Easter. Liturgically, after our celebration today, we will enter into the season of Pentecost, shifting away from specific Easter stories and enter into what has become known as ordinary time. However, one should be cautioned because the season of Pentecost is far from ordinary. It is filled with life-giving stories of how God worked through Jesus and how people were touched by his love, his teaching, and his healing power. As we celebrate Pentecost today, we are reminded of how the disciples and all who were gathered in Jerusalem that day were touched by God, and how God continues to work in the world through the presence of the Holy Spirit. Joyce Rupp, in her book, May I Have This Dance, says, in the chaos, the Spirit of God came with energy beyond their boldest imagination. This coming changed their attitudes and motivated them with enthusiasm and hope. They moved from being weak and discouraged to being people with inner vitality. They discovered a dynamic power of love and a new determination to live what Jesus had proclaimed to them. So people who had been terrorized with their own fears suddenly experienced an immense freedom and a deep sense of God's love within them. With a rushing wind came a surge of courageous energy that was not present before. This is how God works in the world, always and constantly, renewing and creating through the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is always a creative energy that brings about life, building up life, and giving life. The presence of the Spirit is not a new thing. It is recorded in the Scripture from the beginning of time. It is abundantly clear in the text of Genesis that the Spirit was present, hovering over the earth, giving breath and life to the void that existed. The story of God creating something from nothing is nothing short of a miracle. As young people would say, it's awesome. The more one allows oneself to think about God at work in creation, the more awestruck we are. How minute particles are giving rise to energy sources. How nature takes its course in the creation of beautiful flowers and human life. However the Holy Spirit works, one thing is for certain. The world was changed on the day of Pentecost some 2,000 years ago. The day that the Holy Spirit descended to God's people as promised by Jesus prior to his ascending into heaven. Lest you be afraid that a violent wind will sweep you off your feet, let me explain to you how I envisioned that moment in Jerusalem. I envisioned the power of God sweeping down on the nation as many people gathered of different nationalities to celebrate a religious festival. Some phenomenon happened to change those people. What if what really happened on that day was not that everyone spoke the same language or spoke in tongues, but for the first time in the history of the world, this incredible power allowed them to hear and to understand each other and themselves. Not that they spoke some new language, but the Spirit opened their ears and their hearts to hear each other for the very first time. And as Christianity spread, questions arose regarding the nature of the Holy Spirit and how it works in the community and in God's people. There are no definitive answers, but Paul provides us some answers in his letter to the Christian community of Corinth. Paul emphasizes the following, that through the power of the Holy Spirit, there are a variety of gifts or ministries given to each and every one, and that God is the source of all gifts received. He goes on to note that these gifts are not given for our own edification, but for the common good of the church. For Paul, the church is the body of Christ, and states that we are all members of the one body through the Holy Spirit, which we receive in baptism. It is this Spirit that awakens us to the power of God within us, which allows us to hear and understand the gifts and ministries that we have to offer in the church and to the world. Perhaps the Holy Spirit allows us to hear each other with a common mind and purpose, which then allows us to build up and reveal the kingdom of God. Well, today is Pentecost, and hardly anyone realizes it. Yet this day is important because Pentecost is the birthday of the church, and God has given us a wonderful opportunity to be a part of it. As Anglicans, we sometimes have a propensity to dismiss the topic or guard ourselves against too much talk about the Holy Spirit, because perhaps if we were to focus too much on the power of the Spirit, we just might get carried away and begin to see the world in a new light. We might even see that the whole reason for being church is to build up and reveal the kingdom of God. So how are we going to celebrate this day? When we celebrate the birth of Jesus, all the world pauses to celebrate Christmas with us. When we celebrate Easter, we get almost the same response. What do we do to celebrate the coming of the Spirit? Let us first acknowledge that the Holy Spirit is at work here in this place. I see many signs and many gifts and ministries at work here in this church, Well, we see that people are involved in prayer groups, in a prayer chain. Some are involved in community time, and we have those who are involved in setting the stage for us to come here today together so that we may share with the world our word. So let us pause and remember through the music and prayer and the worship that we have heard today that the body of Christ, the church, is empowered by God's power to do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. We'll now have our intercessory prayer.
Our intercessions this morning are found on page 691. Let us pray together to the Lord, saying, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving God, we thank you for your many gifts to us, for the love which brings us together, for the earth which provides for our needs, for the new life you have given us in Jesus Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray to you for our Christian family, especially the congregations of St. James in Christ Church, and for your grace to grow in your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray to you for our world and for all its cares and needs. We pray for peace in the Middle East. We pray for all who lead us and care for us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray to you for those in need, for the sick and the lonely, for the hurt and the frightened, and for those who live without hope. We ask at this time that you pray for those who are on your hearts and minds.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those we love who have died, that you will surround them with your care and love. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for one another, asking you to bless us, our friends and relatives. Bless the places where we work, and bless our homes and our life together.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Most merciful Father, forgive us our sins against you and against each other. Strengthen us to overcome our weaknesses, that we may live in love, as you would have us live. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us say together the Lord's Prayer. As our Savior taught us, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And let us say the prayer for our full-time rector. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the many blessings that you bestow on us each day. You know our needs greater than we do, and we ask that you bring a full-time rector to us who can address those needs. Someone who will embrace us and whom we will embrace. This we ask in your name. Amen.
And we'll say the grace together. I'd like to stand as we say the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,
and the love of God,
and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit,
be with us all, evermore. Amen.
We will now listen to our recessional hymn.